Hey friends, and welcome to MBM Online. Great to have you with us. I'm with Josie Allen. How are you, sister?
I'm doing really well.
Now, you've got some good news for us.
Yeah, I got really exciting news. I just got engaged a couple of weeks ago.
And who's the blessed fella?
Josiah Seto.
Wow, great guy. I think he's a great guy, but it's a big call because you're marrying someone. God willing, he's going to father your children. It's a very big role. Why did you choose Josiah to be the man you're going to become one with?
Yeah, there are many reasons. I think one of the big ones is that he is very honest and upfront with me.
Yeah.
So he's very clear, like good communicator, communicates what he's thinking, what he's feeling, which means I don't have to second guess or feel insecure about it. And he's
but
also...
not in a demanding way.
No, you know, not
you can
at all.
Be, okay, right.
Yeah. No, he's wonderful.
Yeah.
But he's also got such a heart for Jesus and seeing people transformed by Jesus. So he's friends, he's passionate about ministry, and he's passionate about seeing me love Jesus more.
Wow. Yeah. Well, it seems to me Josiah's like every Galea man in our family. We've always married up. You always marry someone better than yourself. That's my rule in life. And sounds like he's done exactly the same thing. Now, we're going to hear a little bit later from Sam Chan. I love Sam's preaching. What is it about his preaching that you get encouraged by?
Oh, I love lots. I think I love that he's really clear and easy to understand, but also super passionate about what he's saying.
Yeah, he is, isn't he? Fantastic. Yeah. Well, now we've got belonging coming up. And friends, if you're new to the church, you're exploring, you want to find out a bit more about what MBM is, what we believe, get to know the staff members, then over the next three Mondays, beginning this Monday, please come and join us. It's online still because of the nature of COVID. And so press the Get in Touch button and we'll send you a Zoom link. And from a safe distance, you'll be able to hear about what we're on about. And I grant you, it only goes for an hour, but it's a really special time where you'll get to know us and we'll get to know you. So I really hope you could join us for that. Well, why don't we turn now to our Father in Heaven in prayer, eh? Father in Heaven, we want to say thank you so much for being a God who's given us life and breath and everything else. And even under the shadow of COVID and restraints, and especially in certain parts of Australia, like our friends in Victoria are doing it really tough. We thank you, Father, for the wisdom of the government and the way they've managed it. We pray, Father, that that the progress that's already been made within Australia will continue and around the world. Our heart goes out, Lord, to those who are doing it tough, and we ask that you would bring on a vaccine for this awful COVID coronavirus. And so, but in the meantime, Lord, we pray that as children of God, we will seek to live for your glory. You do love us, Lord, and we know that it's never more clearer than in the fact that you did not withhold your one and only Son. And we want to praise you, Lord, for being a God who threw out that lifeline that made it possible for us to come into relationship with you through Jesus and to know that everything, that there's nothing rather that we have done that can't be forgiven. And it is such a blessing, and that we get to call you, the judge of all the earth, our dad. We praise you for that in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Well, we're going to praise our God. And I think if I'm not mistaken, fiance Josiah might be leading us in song. So let's praise our God. Crank it up. Let the neighbours hear you praise God because he's worth it.
Come and stand before your Maker, full of wonder, full of fear. Come behold his power and glory, yet with confidence draw near. For the one who holds the heavens and commands the stars above is the God who bends to bless us with an unrelenting love. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. Is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. We are children of the promise, the beloved of the Lord, one with everlasting kindness, bought with sacrificial blood. Bringing reconciliation to a world that longs to know the affections of a Father who will never let them go. Rejoice! Come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice. All our sickness, all our sorrow, Jesus carried up the hill. He has walked this path before us, He is walking with us still. Turning tragedy to triumph, turning agony to praise. There is blessing in the battle, so take heart and stand amazed. Rejoice, when you cry to Him, He hears your voice. He will wipe away your tears. Rejoice, in the midst of suffering, He will help you sing. Rejoice, come and lift your hands and raise your voice. He is worthy of all praise. Rejoice, sing the mercies of your King, and with trembling rejoice.
Hi kids, I'm Josh. The Bible tells us that sin makes a mess of everything, and no matter how hard we try, we can't clean up the mess that sin makes. But there's someone who can. Let's take a look.
In the beginning, God's amazing world was good. It was good because God is good. God could live with Adam and Eve because they were good, just like Him. But then Adam and Eve disobeyed God. And so, for the first time, things in God's beautiful world weren't good. Sin made a mess of everything. Everything from the inside out. Everything, including our bodies. In Mark chapter 1, we meet a man who had to walk around calling out, "Unclean! Unclean!" All the people would run away from him. He was unclean because his skin was covered with leprosy. The man had to live outside the town, all by himself. No one wanted to touch this man. If anyone touched him, they would get leprosy and be unclean. But one day, the man with leprosy went to Jesus. He begged Jesus to make him clean. Jesus looked at the man and smiled. Then he reached out his hand and he touched the man who shouldn't be touched. Jesus said, "Be clean." Immediately the leprosy was gone. He was clean. Only a good and perfect God can clean up the mess sin makes. In fact, Jesus died on the cross to clean up the mess sin has made once and for all. And one day, those who trust in Jesus will be clean inside and out. The mess of sin will be gone forever, and it's all because of Jesus.
Children, Jesus came to clean up the mess of sin, and everyone who asks Jesus to make them clean is clean. So now we can be friends with God. So how good is Jesus? So let's pray to our great God. We praise you, God, that Jesus did what we could never do. He washed our sin away. And we love that now we can be friends with you, now and forever. Amen.
Hey, friends, I'm with Sam Cham. Hey, Sam.
Hey, Ray.
Did I say Chan or Cham?
I don't know. Like,
I think I might have said Cham.
But that works.
Have you ever thought of changing your name to Cham?
People always say Chang. It's funny, like
Chang.
Non-Asians, no matter how many times I say it's Chan, they say, "Oh, Chang." They hear Chang.
Okay,
so I said Chan.
Now, Sam, you work for City Bible Forum.
Yep.
You work part-time as a doctor, and you're preaching for us not too long from now.
That's right.
So thanks for coming. Sam, what's your story? How did you come to know Christ for yourself?
Well, I've got one of those stories where I did grow up in a Christian family. Both my parents were Christians. But as I explain to people, that actually makes it more likely not to be a Christian because as an Asian growing up in Australia, you're very confused about your identity and you're actually trying everything you can not to be Asian because you want your own identity. And at the same time, you're trying, well, you don't want to be a Christian either because your parents are Christian. So for me, I really, really had to check it out and really want to be a Christian.
So when did you kind of own it for yourself?
I think a big key moment was at the age of 16, my school chaplain got us reading the book of Romans systematically and the lights came on. For the first time, justification made sense and the difference between justification and sanctification.
Okay, so can you strip that back for us? So for those...
Well, sanctification is becoming more and more holy, becoming more and more the person that God wants me to be and I want to be. But justification is that one-off moment where God declares you innocent.
Right.
You're one of mine. You're a child of God.
And Jesus has done it all.
He's done it all.
Okay, right.
As I explained to my Asian friends, Jesus is perfect, so I don't have to pretend to be perfect.
And that's a real pressure in the culture. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. And so I explain to people, because right now, if you go to a university, the first thing you know is, there are Asians everywhere. Yeah. There are more Asians here than in Asia. And I say, well, wait till you go to the Christian group on university campus. It's only Asians. You'd be the only white Anglo in there. Somehow the gospel has this resonance, this attraction with Asians.
Right.
And I explain it this way. For an Asian, and I remember this as an Asian kid growing up, my parents were Christian and I could see how that had set me free from the life that my non-Christian Asians had because you see them still trapped in fear, darkness, superstitions, fear of evil spirits, and Jesus just sets you free. It's this freedom from all that.
Now, break it down a bit. How does he actually set you free from that world?
Well, as Asians, we naturally believe in evil spirits, the demonic, some spiritual dark life out there.
So you're always on edge. Yeah, right, okay.
Like there's a whole endless list of things that Asians do, down to the number of your house, the direction your house faces, where you put mirrors in your room.
Right.
So Anglos hear this feng shui, think, oh, no, there's a dark side to it. We're actually stopping evil spirits from taking over the house.
Right.
There's this fear that if you call your dad, the evil spirit will know your dad is your dad and will take his life. So you've actually even got to call him false names so evil spirits can't. And this is the life I see a lot of my Asian friends have. But because my parents believed in Jesus, we were just set free
from that.
From all that.
Because Jesus is Lord of all.
That's
And he is for us.
There's a power
fantastic.
That Jesus gives you.
Sam, that is really helpful. Now, you've got a podcast at the moment, haven't you, on growing up as an Asian?
So I'm Sam Chan and I do this thing with Sam Wan and the podcast is called Espresso. Espressos are the coffee, Espresso and Earl Grey. And we reflect on what it's like to be two Asian Australians growing up in Australia.
Fantastic. Well, God has saved us. Not for us to let go of our culture, but to rise, to be liberated from the fears of our cultures and meet Jesus in all his glory. Sam, thank you so much. Looking forward to hearing you preach a little bit later. And just it's been a real blessing to see you at work in siding with Jesus and persuading others to do likewise. Thanks, brother.
Thanks.
Hello, my name is Ed and I'm part of the 1045 congregation. Today's Bible reading is from the book of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 to 34. When Jesus had again crossed over by boat to the other side of the lake, a large crowd gathered around him while he was by the lake. Then one of the synagogue leaders named Jairus came, and when he saw Jesus, he fell at his feet. He pleaded earnestly with him, "My little daughter is dying. Please come and put your hands on her so that she will be healed and live." So Jesus went with him. A large crowd followed and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had, yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak because she thought, "If I just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" "You see the people crowding around you," his disciples answered. "And yet you can ask, 'Who touched me?'" But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering."
During COVID, it's become normal to wear a mask. And so all my friends are on social media showing off photos of themselves wearing masks. But then they say things like, "Oh, these masks, they're making my glasses fog up." "Oh, these masks, they're making me go cross-eyed." "Oh, these masks, they give me a headache." Now, I work as a doctor, so it's normal for me to wear a mask at work. And I feel like saying, "Oh, please, welcome to my world," but I don't. Because I get it. There's something strange and unfamiliar about what's happening. There's something very broken in our world right now. And the longer we live, the more broken our lives become. It's not just our cars that break down. It's not just our bodies that break down. Our work situations break down. Our relationships break down. We also break down. We become broken people. So our question today is this: what would Jesus say to the broken? Well, g'day, my name is Sam Chan from City Bible Forum. Thanks for having me here. And I'm going to try my best to answer this question. What would Jesus say to the broken? And this is going to come in the form of a 15 or 20 minute talk. And our question comes to us today because in our Bible reading in Mark chapter 5, Jesus meets a broken woman. And we meet her in Mark chapter 5, verse 25. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak because she thought, "If I could just touch his clothes, I will be healed." Immediately, her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once, Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, "Who touched my clothes?" In this Bible reading, we meet a woman, and her body is broken. She has been subject to bleeding for 12 years. So her body is now weak, it's frail, it's fragile, it's fatigued. But it's not just her body that's broken. We also read that financially she's broken. She has suffered under the care of doctors. She's paid all their bills. She is financially broke. But it's not just her finances that are broken. She's also socially broken. In her culture, she is unclean. She's shamed. She's shunned. She's expelled. She's outcast. She is cancelled. And then she comes up behind Jesus and touches the edge of her cloak. And we read that she's immediately healed. But Jesus also stops and says, "Who touched me?" Now, that's the part of the story I just don't get. Because we know in the bigger story of Mark chapter 5, Jesus is on another mission to see a girl, a young girl who's dying. He's only got seconds to spare. He's on an emergency. He's like an ambulance with a sirens flashing. Bah, 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 bah. And now he's stopping for a woman who's been bleeding for 12 years. This can surely wait. Why would Jesus stop now? Because he wants the woman to hear and he wants us to hear what he has to say to her. So what would Jesus say to the broken? Here he says three things. And the first thing that Jesus says to her and the first thing that Jesus says to us is this. Jesus recognizes her brokenness. Now, we read this in verse 31. You see the people crowding against you, his disciples answered, and yet you can ask, who touched me? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Jesus wants to publicly, in front of the crowds, in front of his disciples, he wants to use this as a public teachable moment to recognize this woman's brokenness. I used to live in an apartment and my car used to be parked in the basement garage. And one day I went to my car to drive to work, and as I jumped in my car, that's when I realized I was going nowhere because someone had stolen my steering wheel and someone had stolen my battery. So I had to ring up my mechanic, and my mechanic very kindly came to me and he replaced my steering wheel and he replaced my battery. But notice what my mechanic did not do. He did not turn up and say, "Oh, Sam, you idiot, look what you've done." No, he knew that this is what someone else had done to me. He understood, he cared, he recognized my broken down situation. And Jesus publicly recognizes this woman's broken down situation. As I've heard from another American preacher, he explained it to me in this way. This woman belongs in the category of brokenness. Well, what does this mean? It means it's not so much what she has done, it's what's been done to her. It's not the bad things she's done, bad has been done to her. She hasn't done anything shameful. Instead, she's the one who has been shamed. She belongs in the category of brokenness. Now, that's helpful for us to know because often as well-meaning religious Christians, we only know the category of in the Bible of right and wrong, of sin and guilt. And these are real categories. These are right categories. These are categories that belong in the Bible, that come to us in the Bible. But they're not the only categories because the Bible also has a category of brokenness. And the Bible gives us a story of Job to explain this category of brokenness. Because Job, his life becomes broken. His body becomes broken. His family becomes broken. His heart becomes broken. But then his well-meaning religious friends turn up and they only know categories of right and wrong, sin and guilt. And so they say things like this to Job, "Oh, Job, this is something you have done. You have done wrong. You have sinned. You are guilty. You need to repent." But the Bible says, no, Job was a righteous person. He was a broken person. This isn't anything wrong he has done. Wrong has been done to him. And this woman is the same. She belongs in the category of brokenness. And it's interesting in that Mark 5 reading, the Bible uses all these passive verbs to explain that things have happened to the woman. She has been subject to bleeding. She has suffered under the care of doctors. So this isn't anything she has done. It's what has happened to her. She belongs in a category of brokenness. And this brings us to the second thing that Jesus wants to say to her. And it's this. Jesus reverses her brokenness. Verse 32, but Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Jesus reverses this woman's brokenness. Now, I used to have an Alfa, and an Alfa is a gorgeous car. It's red, it's beautiful, it's fun to drive, but an Alfa is also an Italian car. Like, what could go wrong with an Italian car, right? Everything. So my car was always breaking down. It used to break down so often that often it would be just parked on my front lawn for weeks or even months, not moving. So my wife, Stephanie, nicknamed it the garden gnome because that's exactly what it was. It was like a garden gnome just parked on my front lawn, not moving. But one time I did get it moving, and I remember driving it around, but suddenly it had no reverse gear. So there was one night I remember being stuck in Sydney because I was trying to do this three-point turn, but I had no reverse gear, so I couldn't reverse. So instead, I just kept going forward and forward and forward, and I kept getting more and more and more stuck. And this woman is the same. She is so broken. She has no reverse. She just gets more and more and more stuck in her brokenness. The more she bleeds, the more broken her body becomes. The more broken her body becomes, the more she bleeds. The more she is financially broken, the more she's in debt. But the more she's in debt, the more financially broken she becomes. And the more cut off she becomes from society, the more shamed she becomes. The more shamed she becomes, the more cut off she becomes. She becomes more and more broken. She cannot reverse. But Jesus comes and reverses her brokenness. Where she was once trapped, she's set free. Where she once had private shame, Jesus gives her public honor. Where she once had disorder and chaos, Jesus gives her peace, shalom. So what is this peace? What is this shalom? During the isolation lockdown period, we all played around with jigsaw puzzles. And we all know how jigsaw puzzles work. As we open the box, we begin with disorder, pieces everywhere. But bit by bit, as we assemble the puzzle, we bring more and more order until there's that final moment as we click the final piece into its right place and we have this moment, a moment of peace, shalom, because everything is where it should be. And Jesus comes and brings peace and shalom into this woman's life. Everything is where it should be. So how does Jesus bring peace to this woman? Well, this brings us to the third thing that Jesus says to this woman, and it's this. Jesus redefines her brokenness. Verse 34, and he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering." Jesus redefines her brokenness. She's now no longer the broken one. Instead, she's now a daughter, a child of God. My children are still at the age where I can do the daddy school drop-off. And I love doing the daddy school drop-off because that means every morning I get to hold their hand as I walk them. I get to hug them goodbye and I get to give them a kiss as they leave. But I know this is only going to last for a few more years because as they grow up, there's going to be that moment where they're not going to want to have a daddy school drop-off. They're not going to want me to hold their hand. They're not going to want me to hug them. And they're certainly not going to want me to kiss them in public, being like, "Dad." But I'm okay with that because I understand as they grow up, they need to find their own identity. So what's our identity going to be? How are we going to be defined? Well, we can define ourselves by what we do. But that's only going to make us proud and insecure because we can never do enough. Well, we can be defined by what's been done to us, but that's always going to make us the victim. We're always going to be defined by the worst that has happened to us. We'll never be able to move on. Or we can be defined by Jesus. We can be a child of God and we can be defined by who Jesus is and what he's done for us. I love that final vision in the book of Revelation where Jesus is on his throne and he's surrounded by his people, surrounded by the family of God, surrounded by God's children. And in this vision, it says, if we're a child of God, we are dressed in robes of white. And what that means is this: at that moment, when God sees us, he doesn't see us as defined by what we've done. We're not defined by what's been done to us. We are defined by Jesus. God sees us in the robes of Jesus, in his righteousness, defined by who Jesus is and what he's done for us. That means for those of us who have very broken down lives, and we've all got broken down lives, our relationships are broken down. For many of us, there's separation, there's divorce. Maybe our businesses have broken down, our finances have broken down, and our bodies have broken down. And maybe we feel we can't even come to church. There's too much shame. We're going to be judged. But Jesus says, come to me, and you will be defined by who Jesus is and what he's done for us. And that also means for those of us who do turn up to church, when we see the people around us at church, we need to see them the same way God sees them, in robes of white, defined by who Jesus is and what he's done for us. So do you remember our original question today? It was this: what does Jesus have to say to the broken? And today we've heard three things. One, Jesus recognizes our brokenness. Number two, and then Jesus can reverse our brokenness. How? By number three, he redefines our brokenness. We are now known as children of God. I remember when I was a young medical student, I got to sit in a dermatology, a skin disease clinic. And I remember this woman came in and she had this horrible, painful, disfiguring skin disease. And as she described her disease to the doctor said, I know exactly what you have. This is what your disease is caused. This is what your disease is called. This is what you're suffering. And this is what you're experiencing. And as he said this, this woman's eyes lit up. She goes, yes. And she started crying tears of joy. And she said, you're the first person who gets it. You're the first person who understands me. And then she said, but what can you do for it? And that's when the doctor said, well, there's nothing we can do. And at that moment, her face just fell. But with Jesus, we have someone who doesn't just recognize our brokenness. He has the power to reverse our brokenness. In Jesus, we can find healing, restoration, forgiveness, and Jesus redefines our brokenness. So we don't have to be defined by what we've done or what's been done to us. Instead, we are now defined as children of God, defined by who Jesus is and what he has done for us.
Your mercy, Lord, reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness to the clouds above. Your righteousness like a mountain. Your judgments fall deep into my heart. heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds above, your righteousness like a mountain, your judgments fall.
It was awesome. I love the line in it, your mercy, God, reaches to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds above. It is such an awesome picture of God's love and how great it is.
Yeah, the vastness. Yeah. It's a Mark Benici original, isn't
it? Yeah.
He's a gifted man. I'm so glad he's writing more songs and such a blessing to us at MBM. And that passage, wow, it melts your heart just to see here is a woman, 12 years continually bleeding, doctors unable to help, unable to access the temple privileges, which was really the presence of God. And then in one touch, Jesus allows her to access God directly face to face. What a great God. He just kind of reverses and undoes and reconstitutes everything.
Yeah.
Friends, we just want to say, don't forget, we've got Belonging coming on.
We do. Belonging starting tomorrow, and you can book in for that using the Get In Touch link. So I'm looking forward to seeing you there.
Absolutely. Please join us because it's such a special time. We get to know you, you get to know us, and looking forward to it. I just want to say I thank God so much for your generosity. It's because of your generosity that the word of God has gone out, not only in the western suburbs of Sydney, but around the world. Our overseas ministry partners are funded by your generosity, the staff, all the infrastructure. So we thank God for making that happen. And, you know, at the end of this time together, we've got the discussion and prayer time. Sandy and I find that just such a special time where we get to integrate what's been taught to us, to praise our God, to confess, and use it as a special time of deep fellowship with those in the household. Well, Josie, next week it's...
the Book of Acts.
Oh, wow, that is an amazing letter. Yeah. And I'm so looking forward to preaching chapter one. It's just already got me excited.
Yeah.
And we're going to go right through 2 and 4 looking at the Book of Acts. So, friends, look forward to seeing you then and have a great week. See you later.
See you later.